But it's what works for me. I go about it my way, and that kind of just happens probably for everybody. They find their own place to go, where they create their thing. I used to outline my trees and elements, barns, whatever it would be, get a mix of color and just draw it. You know, outline it, sketch it. Excuse me. What I'm finding now for trees, what I've been doing, is just mixing a dark color, let's say a shadow shape. By the way, I have that tree, that's a sycamore, but I also have this tree, if you'd rather. Because I drove around looking for, this is a maple. This is my favorite tree, the sycamore.
This
is
your favorite.
The sycamore?
Yeah.
Thanks. Now this is 16 by 20 or something, and I usually paint 14 by 18, these larger ones, and 12 by 16 because they fit in my cart bag. Mm-hmm. That's really the only reason. I don't paint small. I try to paint as big as I can get away with. And most of these paintings are done pretty close to finish, and then if I have a show coming up or something like that, I'll pull them off the shelf and then finish them. And that might mean cleaning up areas or, you know, reinventing stuff. This painting over here was one I just finished up before I came here, because I realized after pulling things off my shelf, I didn't have any summer painting. One thing to note, this group of sycamores here are the same ones as this one, except from a different angle. Wolf tree again. This was at Wolf Lake Fish Hatchery in Kalamazoo. Just behind this tree is actually M43. But clearly, what are we going to do? So I eliminated the road and pushed the scene back, pushed the horizon down, pushed the clouds down, and now the tree's got some mass in it. It makes it look a little more grand. This was painted at Chipman Preserve in Kalamazoo, also Southwest Michigan Land Conservancy. And then when they walked by me, they left this path in the snow, and I thought, that really... So I'll just start painting and just explaining my process, which is kind of inside out. It doesn't necessarily work for all, you know, everything. And what I mean by that is this. If I'm painting a tree close up, like this, where it's really near me, I'll go ahead and pretty much paint the main branches and the main trunk and nothing else, because it's close to me, so I want to get a little more detail, a little more texture, and that's going to take time. So I focus on that, and then after I had the main branches, and there's, you know, a few, not many, not these secondary deals, those came later, then I start painting the background in around it, because now I've got my center of interest, what I call the star of the show. And these then become supporting cast. Mm-hmm. Their job is to make the star of the show jump. So that's my approach. Then if it's something like this, and I know there's lots of busyness in the branches, I'll scrub in the sky first. Mm-hmm. Maybe lay in the grass. Sometimes I get in the weeds with that because I start fiddling with that so much, I never get back to what really the focus of my painting is. But in this case, I think it worked out okay. The gap in this, and then because it's a painting, and I'm the art director of this painting, I'm not shy about moving things in, out, eliminating them, whatever works. So in this case, there was not much of a gap. I opened the gap up and added the little, I'm still not sure I like that. Before I had it, it created a real true circle, and I see it still kind of doing that. So yes. I'm mixing French ultramarine blue and rose madder, and I'm getting kind of a dark It'll look black to you, but it's actually has a lot of color in it. And what I start to do is I do a real thin wash, super thin. And that's going to be my base dark right off the bat. I can, here's a little transparent oxide red to add some brown, and a touch of sap green gives it a nice earthy color. Now, here's where I'm going to go a little different. Normally, what we do is we look and we draw, you know, we draw this out like this. But what I've been doing lately, watch, I'll shoot myself in the foot here. And if I do, well, that's the way life is. Okay, I'm taking a bigger brush, and I just start laying it in. This is going to be pretty bouncy. And I just try to mimic. And I'm not concerned. I could care less if I get out here and things go haywire. I don't care. Those things I clean up as I go along. It gives me a little bit of freedom. It kind of helps that the photograph ends up being nearly the same size as the. And the reason I do this, and I've been doing it a lot lately, is I can see the silhouette of it better than if I drew it out where it has two sides. Mm-hmm. Especially when you get up into branches like this, I lose track of myself real fast. So this way I'm seeing it as a silhouette. We'll see. Did I already explain the textured canvas thing?
No.
Oh, well, that's why I shot myself in the foot this week. I was looking through a David Curtis book, who's a British painter, who I admire quite a bit, and I noticed that one of his paintings, or not just one, many of his paintings, have this extra texture that a canvas doesn't have. So I went to the store and bought flexible acrylic medium. And, you know, for weeks now I've been doing this. And I just paint right over the gesso, or right over the prime gesso, the canvas. Set it up and then paint. And I liked it. I liked how it looked. Well, I thought, well, if some texture's good, a lot must be better. That's not good. So what happened is, now there's so much, and I did all 14 of my canvases out here that way. So what's happening is this is filling in nicely because it's all turpentine, you know, it's loose. What if I had dry paint? It tends to skip, and it looks like, I don't know, ragged paper or something. I'm gonna use these brushes on the other side. So lesson learned, you know, I suppose.
Hopefully.
Probably not. And just make, you know, kind of get in the neighborhood. I usually don't concern myself a whole lot with, and you'll notice I'm not doing any background, you know. And again, it's because the tree's up close. I'm going to add that, probably not tonight, obviously, but unless there's time, I'll throw in a sky or something, but. Because there's just so few main branches, I can go ahead and paint the tree first and get into the meat of it. Oops. So that's really all I need for now. Just kind of have a little goo coming down here. So then after I have that started, now remember, it looks black, but it has violet in it, it has green in it, it has brown in it. Has ultramarine blue in it. It's all color. There's no black there at all. So now what I do is take another large brush. Oh, the other thing about the texture thing, it kills your brushes like right now. Because I'm scrubbing it on this, it's like sandpaper kind of. So now I take another larger brush, and I'm kind of trying to be mindful of where the shadow shapes fall on the tree. Sycamores have this lovely gray-green to them, oftentimes. Whichever way the sun's going, and this is a good example when it doesn't happen this way, usually shadow shapes, especially when you look at them on a house, shadow shapes follow the direction of the sun. So in this case, for the most part, the sun's coming this way. You can see this is the light side of the tree, but notice how this one fights the other direction slightly. But the shadow shapes on a tree help explain the form of the tree. So use these bends because it adds that look of roundness to your tree. Now I'm mixing a gray-green, and I let that color underneath work with me. And it's going to be dark at first, but I can build into that. Especially at the bottom. The danger, of course, is that you can get muddy if you're not too careful. But the reason it shouldn't go too muddy on you is because you're painting with color and not with pure black. And you can go back in and rebuild these shadow shapes too, by the way. But it's better if you kind of can try to leave them because they're markers of where you are in the tree. Here's a branch that's on the far side of the tree. It's in shadow, so we'll leave it that way. I don't use titanium white. I use Permalva white. It's a buttery white. It just, they say it's opaque. Sharon, what do you know about that? I've always thought of it as being more transparent, but.
I used to use Permalva, and I agree, it's really a very nice white, and it's very juicy. But I switched, and I'm using either Gambling's or Leafcart's white right now, which has a little bit more body to it, but not a lot. But just enough, and I think it's a little bit more opaque than Permalva.
Okay. Is that a titanium white
when you
truck? Okay.
Right now I've just mixed a little bit of yellow, more yellow, and I'm laying it over the top of this. What I like about what happens if I do it this way, brush strokes take on a stronger meaning. They become the texture of the bark. I try not to, what I call pet the dog, where you go 400 times thinking you're getting something going somewhere. I try to lay it on and let the color work together. Sometimes it works.
Can you tell us again what the gray-green mixture was you started with?
The gray-green?
Yes.
It was cobalt blue with yellow ochre, a touch of quinacridone red, or it could have been rose madder, with white. I don't worry about what it looks like here so much. It's when it gets here. Now, here's the thing. If this were a white canvas, this would look different. It's all relative. This looks dark, but if I put a black next to this now, it gets brighter. You know, it's all whatever's next to it kind of thing. So, I just read Richard Schmid's book, A la Prima, and his theory, which is an excellent book, I just love it. His theory is why mix a color wrong the first time when you can mix it right the first time. His theory is find that color, mix that color, place that color where it belongs. Then move to the next thing next to that, mix that color, get that color right, place that color, and the painting will paint itself as you work your way around. I don't know if you know his work or not, but he often takes a huge brush and just, you know, lets the background go. And he builds almost in patchwork quilt kind of way out. Lightning, trying to lighten this outside edge. But I'm not keeping track of what's on my brush because I'm talking. I'm laying paint on thick. One thing I noticed about a lot of people, of whether it's right or wrong, little tiny puddles of paint, almost like, that's it. That's all I'm using the rest of the day. You gotta put tons of paint on. Tons of paint. Because really, you're going to use it the next day anyway, and it'll be there for you. This way, you're not afraid to use your paint, and you get nice, thick, juicy looking paintings. And this will all look up here's a shadow shape skipping up, and then this rides on top a little bit. Right now I'm using the same color, but it's easy for me to adjust that color to whatever I want it to be down the road. And I'm rolling my brush in my fingers. It allows that bead of paint to roll right off onto the can, onto the... And I'm not using any oil medium. If I did, it would slide right on the top, which would be good. But this gives you, I can put tons of paint on, well, relatively tons, and it has a nice texture when I'm done that I like. Out here, this branch is kind of catching a little bead of light. Some of that other color stays there. And then I can come back if I take a smaller brush and I see the shadow shape is there, right here. I can build that out. Now this big lump is going to disappear on me. I'm going to lose that eventually. And I don't get too hung up on being photographically accurate. I don't. If I did that, then I might as well just go in the studio and paint from a photo. This branch up here is really green, or greenish. So I'm going to make him let's make him a little more green. And I'm rolling. I don't want to destroy all of that black. I want some of that. And when I say black again, it's not black. It has that color in it. So when I add a little touch of white, that would actually probably turn blue, parts of it. Here's another branch. Here's a one lesson that's really important. To get volume, some of these branches coming out, and again, if you've had my workshops, you'll have heard me say this before. Here's a good example. Branches that come towards you, out towards you, you're seeing the shadow side underneath. And branches that move away from you, you're seeing the upper side. So branches on the far side of the tree, up here, they catch more light, generally. This is just generally. And branches that move out towards you are usually darker underneath and often have a little bump of reflected light, probably not that high up in the tree because it's not near the ground. But so these little things like that give this tree dimension because we read that as coming out towards us and higher up because it's coming up out of that tree, out of the tree towards us. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of one of those little fun things to remember when you're out there fiddling around. Okay, where was I? Up here. So here's a branch that's coming out towards us a little bit, but it's got color in it. And that one's a little lighter. Here's a browner one here. So first I lay these patches of color in. And then I go in and start adjusting them a bit. This kind of jazz, I don't worry about because I can take, because this I toned it a while ago, and I really don't even need to do this except it would probably bleed through so much. I just can dip this in and wipe that in the negative right down. Now it meets the tree.
And what are you dipping into?
Turpentine, yeah. This is terpenoid. Mm-hmm. This is my oil medium, which is one part stand oil and four parts turpentine or turpentine. So it's just a little,
A little bit more viscosity?
Yeah, it's a little oilier and allows me to, if I wanted to put another color over the top and not pick up that color underneath, it allow me to glide that right over the top of it. I'm going to try and knock some of these darks down. I still want them to live in the dark area, but I don't want them to be quite so dark. So I'm going to bring them up in value. sycamores have this wonderful twisty, dancy thing happening all the time. This is a little lighter here, this upright branch. Another thing, vertical branches tend to be darker than, this makes sense, horizontal or arching branches. Vertical catch less light. Matt Smith did this in a video. I've started painting my skies pure white first and then adding the color on the canvas rather than mixing on my palette. And I was surprised to see that he did that.
He
owes me some money. What's that?
He does it with the snow also.
Oh, yeah. So I just get white and I just start scrubbing that in. I'm rolling it right next to the tree, and I do a lot of painting in the negative, trying not to pick up too much of the tree. I'll add the blue in a little bit here.
He's going to mix it on the canvas.
I could go ahead and mix the blue here. I could. But this allows me to see what the blue is doing as I'm putting it on. And the smaller branches will just slide right over the top of this. Notice how the value of this branch hardly showed much, but now that I'm getting white next to it, all of a sudden it's a dark branch. Or a darker branch. Again, it's relative, dark compared to what. The beauty of what doing this, like in the reverse, you can create super sharp edges. And that's beneficial in some cases, but the downside to that is the reason you don't want to do that all the time, or at least in any case, actually, is the tree can actually start looking like it's pasted on top of us. Because the edges are so sharp. So then, let's just pretend I have the whole thing covered the way I like. Then I just take a pinprick of, this is cobalt blue, and then I start to design with it. I kind of figure out where I'm going to go. If I need it darker at the top, apparently I touched some green somewhere along the line because it's not very pure. And then I can pull that in. Whoops, Richard, you didn't do that. There's a difference between French ultra green blue and cobalt blue. I start with cobalt with my skies quite often. And then I just build in. But this isn't about painting skies, so I just don't want to spend too much time on it. But I want to show you how easy that is to feather that in. And you get these wonderful... I'm rolling my brush in my fingers to make this bead of blue run right down that edge. If you have questions, don't be shy.
Are you putting a wash of blue over the white, or are you mixing up blue and white?
They're doing both. Okay. And to answer Andrea's question, right now I'm pulling that right next to that tree, and I'm not leaving orange. But that orange sometimes peeking through looks kind of cool. And then once I have the sky covered, bad news. Then I go back in and I start building my secondary branches. And out here, where I don't have branches, and I just fill in. I'm just trying to ground things down here so we see the value of the tree next to them. Scrub in everything, and then go back and modify it. So this is going to represent my distant trees right for now. You can see I'm way warm. But then when I mix a green to go over it, it's a little loose, but I can just lay it on top and let some of that violet show through. I don't rub it in so it's thoroughly mixing. I let my brush and the canvas pull the paint off. These are distant trees, so this would be like a supporting cast thing. You have to forgive me, Mark. We don't have time to really get.
Now, would you have, typically then you'd have your whole sky, the upper portion of your painting, all flushed in,
well,
blue, and then you start working your way down, or would you scrub in everything first?
I, honest to God, I whatever interests me at that moment. If I'm looking at the tree and I notice a branch, I want to, oh, I gotta go there, I go there. If I see down here, I see something I want to fiddle with, I don't.
Okay,
it's not like watercolor where you have to have a certain way you, you know,
right.
Watercolor you have to build with your lights to your darks, while in oil paint you try to build your darks to light. It's like your own handwriting. After a while you just, you do it and that's what makes, like we talked about in the critiques, Laura, her paintings are so uniquely hers. For her to paint, try to paint like me would be silly. It's, she has her own thing already. And the same is true with branches on a tree. Half of these things are squiggly lines that go nowhere. Now, for some people who are scientific illustrators, like the people that you see have artwork in the hallway, they probably drop dead seeing something like this. But it's not necessary. From a distance, you read it as twigs on a tree and you understand it. And it's far more interesting, I think, and it sure is a lot more fun to paint. Same here. I painted this as a haze. Scrubbed it in. It's just a haze. This pine tree is a black, reddish smudge. Done. Move on. All the way through. Of course, I make it sound like that's easy. Obviously, if they all worked out, I wouldn't scrape off half of them. But same thing here. That hazy, scrubbed in look, heavy scrubbed in thing, is just the background for the trees I'm building in front.
Right.
I don't worry about the twigs and jazz. You know, jazz. Okay, let me just put in just a little bit more sky so I can put some twigs in and make sense of it. This easel, by the way, is not meant to be, this is a 20 by 16, so I had to duct tape a mast. Mr. Jerry Rig here, but it worked, so it worked. And the other thing nice about this white paint first, you can build in some cool clouds. You just paint in the negative. Rather than paint the clouds, you paint the blue. You know, you build around it. You know, I could build a cloud right there by painting around that. And then going in with white, and a pinprick of like ochre or something, and build the top half of that. You know, bingo presto. Of course, that's dark, but that's how you could do a cloud, and now you've painted it in the negative. So it kind of works out kind of cool, or can.
That would have messed you up. That would have messed you up. You.
Maybe yes, maybe
but
yes.
Richard said this works.
I'm going to kill him. Okay. Enough of this. And one thing about skies, now that we're talking about trees, as you near the horizon, it warms up. So here's my white. As I come down here, even here, it's becoming more violet.
Would you have put that all the way down? Well, maybe yes, maybe no, but typically speaking, do you bring your sky down as far as you think it goes and with the white and then put those background trees in?
Yeah, see this tree here?
Yeah.
I wouldn't try to paint around that, it's just too much. So I would go ahead and put my sky in, warm it up with a pinprick of that's cad yellow deep. What's that?
I was saying, when you started putting the sky in and then you stopped and put the background trees in, would you maybe have gone and done the whole sky all the way down as far as you thought it was going to go before it hit the top of those?
Yes. Oh, I see. Before I put these in?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, maybe. Yeah, you could.
Okay.
If it, you know. Now let's start adding some branches. Well, I never worked this big, first of all. And I actually should clean my palette because I've just got tons of paint on it now. So I'm going to add some of the darker branches into that sky. So I'm touching rose madder, French ultramarine blue, and a little bit of transparent oxide red. Sycamores, as the branches go outward, sycamores tend to get little redder twigs. So let's add this to that and make this branch look like it has enough weight to hold that. This is getting lost. Like he's supposed to be sort of white, so. Here's a branch coming up from here. I'm sorry, I'm going to step in front of you a second. And then this shoots up. I do need to add a little bit of blue to the other side of this so I can see. And here.
And is there primary reason for doing this technique where you do the background secondarily to the main tree? Is that because I notice when I'm doing a branch, my background bleeds into the branch and there's no way to get the dark side?
Well, like I said in the beginning, first please understand that if I were actually out there working on something like this, I wouldn't be just slapping paint on like I'm doing now. I'd be actually looking really hard. And, is that darker than that? Is that lighter than that? Is that softer than this? Is the value, that's what I'd be doing all the time. But the reason I'm doing that this way, especially this way, is because shadow shapes on a tree when you're outside and the tree is close to you change super fast, dramatically fast. So my goal when I'm working on a tree like that and is not to worry about the background. I could care less at that point. I've got more important fish to fry by getting these shadow shapes right and building the structure of my tree. That's why I do the sky and everything else later. Okay. Now, in a case like this, it didn't matter so much because the tree's far enough away, there was some cast shadow in the snow, so I went ahead and built everything kind of all at the same time. Same with this. A little more here. There's not so many cross shadows and things.
So you would approach it different ways depending on
yes.
the subject.
Yep. Yes. Okay. Yeah. This here, I did the sky first in the snow. And then scrubbed in the stuff here. And then built the white over the top of it. But when I'm doing a tree this size and this big, then I do the tree first because the shadow there is changing so fast. And if you can nail them down and get them where they're supposed to be, then you can have fun and go on to other things. There's that shadow here. This is quite dark under here. And then I start building the limbs more beefy too, adding weight to them a little bit. See that gray green that sits on top? Well, you maybe can't from where you're sitting, but right on top of this tree is a beautiful gray green that sits kind of right on top. So I just take it lightly and pull it with my brush. It gets a little lighter out on the end. Out here. And see how I lost that? So then what you do, is what I do anyway, is I just take a little bit of blue and paint into the from the other side negatively and create that edge. This would be a fussy thing I'd do at the end. I wouldn't worry too much about it on the front end, but this can show you how that can create that edge. Now that branch exists. One thing I'm still trying to figure out, sometimes I put paint on and the part that has the darker paint ends up on the one side of the brush more than the other. And if I could figure out how to always know where that is. This branch is quite brilliant out here, white. And then suddenly dips the other direction down, and then back up. And it's impossible to keep track of all of them, so I do a few and hope for the best. But now, because that bump is there and we've figured out where that is, some things, you know the eye tree, Tina, that you had? If you actually, she found a tree in the forest, beech tree, that has a perfect eyeball on it. It's got the shape and a round circle inside that. Some things like this can look, what's the word, cornball, is the word I can think of.
Faked
or something. We know it's real because we're seeing it in a photograph. Sometimes if you put them in a painting, they can look. It's the odd thing that the eye goes to first when people, what is that, a porcupine on that tree? So some of that you have to, now see how this shadow shape is pretty heavy dark. Now I'm going to add a little bit of green on the inside of that and pull it in. It hardly did anything. That's how deep that is. And now you're starting to see a little bit of the glow underneath that shadow of the tree itself. Get a little bit of white and punch this up. Up above, here. The beautiful thing about sycamores for me is that you get to play with the bark and create textures and stuff just for fun. Ooh, that was not good. It's too gray. It's too brown. I think it needs more yellow green. So I just do that. I just add it to it.
You put blue in the white of the sycamore sometimes, like it's reflecting the sky?
Yep, if it makes sense.
Uh-huh.
Look how yellow this tree gets as it comes down there. I don't want to destroy the dark side of the tree. I'm going to create a dark side to this. It's too dark. So I lighten it up a bit. And that creates that edge on the other side. Good Lord.
That looks good. Goodness.
Easy crowd.
How long did that painting take you?
What, this one?
Isn't that what people always ask? How long did that take you to do that? I don't know, I was in the zone. That looks good.
Here's the blue that Catherine was talking about. I add right into that. sycamores have that flaky bark.
Does it have kind of a peach color in it sometimes? The flakies, like light brown and peach.
There's actually
kinds of weird colors in it.
In London or in England, they call them planes. Sycamores are called planes.
Really?
Yeah.
I've heard of a plane tree, but I know it's the same tree.
Yeah. I can't get my brush down that way.
Is that kind of a sienna, light sienna?
Well, I was trying to get a little deeper than this. I don't like that bump. I don't care if it was there. It looks stupid. So I'm going to take him out.
What do you think of art when an artist goes about that far and then leaves it unfinished?
It's unfinished.
I mean, some artists do that. They leave it at that stage.
You see a lot of behind portraits.
Yeah, portraits and sometimes something like a tree or something.
They'll
just leave it unfinished, the edges all undone.
Over here, there's a shadow shape right there, so I'm just going to highlight up here. I love this area right here. So there's the crotch of this tree has a dark element to it. I'm going to first put the yellow green in, and then kind of head up towards the shadow shape. And see, the blue is not strong enough. The only reason that that's reading is because that blue is so powerful. But first I'm going to put the shadow shape, this little funky thing here, back in. And then pull this darker element underneath the branch and give it a dark side. Mix a white, a little warm white. I don't know what the heck I touched, but somehow or another it's fighting me. Here, get a nice warmer white. You know who to check out whose paintings have this kind of thick look. Now here, now I'm bringing some lights down here. It's kind of soft at first. I don't want to destroy the dark side of the tree, but I want to pull this front edge up. So I'm just letting this kind of dance around. I'm not following the photo very well, but it's starting to take on the feel a little more of a sycamore having that mottled kind of look. This shadow's too thick, it's too similar to that one. So let's just carve into it and let it do its thing. Pull it down the other way from the back side. And then you can mix. That tree has a really dark edge, and I've kept part of it, but I've lost part of it. So I'm going to go back and reestablish that. French ultramarine blue, rose madder, staying in my own light, a little sap green and a little transparent oxide red. And because I didn't clean my brush, it's got a little touch of cobalt. And then, as I did with the others, I just pull that up from the bottom. It's too green. Well, if you were here, you could see, you'd see some green in it. That's not good, but a little warmer right there. It It's unfortunate, this shadow of this tree, let's put that in. Shadows of trees are most, the deepest part of it is right at the trunk. Because less light can get around the trunk to eat at the edges. The further away the shadow moves from the tree, more light filters in and starts eating at it, so it becomes necessarily softer, and the branch shapes become less defined the further out it goes. Change your paint rags quite a bit. I'm going to just take 5 seconds here to scrape this off because I got another mark on here. Again.
Do you use a glass palette or
yes.
Glass?
My old palette, before I used to tone my canvases, my old palette I used to use a gray. I'd spray paint the back side of the glass a medium gray, middle gray, and then squirt a little bit of silicone. It's cut exactly to 12 by 16 and press it down. But it dawned on me that when I started toning these, the wood color was very similar to my toned canvas, so why not keep it in the same ballpark? Mm-hmm. Whether it makes a difference, I have no idea really.
Mm-hmm.
The way I paint is so off the cuff and...
Well, it makes sense.
Okay. The towels I use are Scott towels, those workman towels you can get in the auto department. They're kind of nice. I think they're a little more, they stand up a little better to wear and tear, especially on coarse canvas. But I'm mixing, I'm going to try and create this shadow shape. So I just touched Viridian, French ultramarine blue, and I'm going to touch a little bit of transparent oxide red just to darken it up. And maybe a little bit of... I'm trying an experiment. After reading Schmidt's book, he uses cadmium lemon yellow. I've always used cadmium yellow pale. And I really don't know what the difference is at this point much, but do you know, Sharon?
Well, there's a tad more blue or green, whichever way you want to look at it, in the lemon.
In the lemon. That's good to know. All right, so here we go. Let's see if we can get this somewhat in the ballpark. So I leave it kind of sharp there because it's right near the tree, and then as I fan it out, I just roll the brush in my fingers and let the, because no one's going to go, well, my God, that's not that branch. They're not going to do that. So you can pretty much come out here and then if you have to, you can reestablish. Of course, what's wrong with this is I've got the shadow going all the way out to the lower 40, but.
Well, it's a tall tree.
There's your answer.
And the sun is setting.
Yeah. And it's going downhill. I can see that, too. Okay, we got 10 minutes. I'm going to break in some sky holes here so this kind of looks a little more. Again, I'm just letting the canvas take it off my brush. I like to sometimes eat into the shape, like this is a roller coaster, so I break that up. Pick up some of this color and then drag it down, and I'm lightly letting go. Over here, up here, soften it down, it's too bright. You know, oops. Sky holes are, that's a little strong. But what can, you know, so a lot of times you can create a gap in there. Let's just say we created a gap here. I'm So now the trees are overarching kind of thing. This tree here, he's a supporting cast dude. Whether I'd actually put him in or not, I don't know. But there's, but you, what you're trying to do is capture his profile more than anything else.
You're pushing up on the brush, which is really shy.
Look how he's being hit with light. It's too bad I shouldn't have done that. I should have, because he's being smacked with so much light. I'm going to put this back in next to him. And I'm going to let him, who was I talking to today? We got talking about counter changes when, let's just do one thing. This tree that's getting hit with light down here, you notice it's light, and the minute it starts hitting a lighter element behind it, it turns into a silhouette. So we can do the same thing, but the transition's got to be the same kind of deal. You know? So it comes up and then turns into a. So he's a good supporting cast dude. The top of it is hazy, so I mix a little violet. And it's not always violet, sometimes depending on what it is. It could be darker. I'm gonna touch a little bit of brown in this. Out to this side. These are all the twigs that grow to the outside. And I'm just rolling my brush and letting it pull it off. Now that was pure white on the end of my brush, but because I rolled it in my paint, it picked up that yellow underneath. And it has many branches or trunks. It almost looks like it's an elm, but elms are pretty rare. If they even exist anymore, I don't know. For those of you who were not here, our very first, I think it was our first day, may have been our second, well, whatever day Brian Smith was here, we're painting down by the highway, down by the narrow bridge, not the highway, and a bald eagle flew in. Landed in the tree. Made that my day. I thought that was it. Out here, I'm going to put a little dark shadow behind this. I will make that. Mm-hmm. Front of that pink pot. Hit some darks in here. So anyway, what I would do from here then is just start picking out secondary branches and building them in. And most of them would be dark, but where they turn and face the light, I just roll my brush and pull them. This is actually quite white, but because it's against the brown, it's not going to show much. This over here. So what would I do? I build it from the backside by taking the blue.
Strategically not placing a cloud there.
Right. Not fighting myself this time. And then from the front side, top side. And these little things of orange that pop through that Andrea's talking about, whether I leave them or don't leave them. I kind of like them sometimes, show them a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah.
On the watercolors?
Yeah.
Oh, one thing I didn't do, I just want to mention a little bit, is just at the bottom, it's warmer down here. So, a little pinky, a little too much pinky, carve into that a bit, and some of these brush strokes, I mean, you can smooth it out, but you can leave some of that jazz.
If you were to soften the side of the tree or some of those branches where it's hit the sky, do you go back in and try to soften with blue or?
So, you mean the edges?
The edges.
Probably what I do is get a clean brush, wipe my brush off pretty clean and dry, and then just pull it.
And just pull, okay.
Yeah, just go next to it and gently take off the color.
Okay.
Here is more of the mottled light of the sunshine hitting the tree. Up here is quite bright. Not bright enough. All right. Up here, more white. So you can just do this, it's a blast. And then you just have fun all day making branches.
What do you put when your paintings are finished? Do you use Damar varnish,
no,
or what do you use?
I don't spray them at all, except when I see one that I want to finish, then I spray retouch varnish.
Okay.
And that allows the new paint to adhere to the old paint, and it also makes all of the sheen the same. Emil Gruppe said he never varnished his paints. He said his dad did, and Charles Gruppe, and he said over time, of course that was way back in the day, so they probably didn't have the right chemicals. And
well, they're not using that kind of varnish anymore because of the fact that it's too hard to get off, so if you have to repair the painting, it generally will take some of the paint off. That's why they use Gambar, because it's very easily removed.
Mm.
You can take it off and, you know, clean the painting and redo it again. It won't damage the paint at all.
Oh.
Well, gambling is kind of a thing.
It's kind of come as a spray can? Or do you have to brush it on?
No, you have to brush it on. But what I do is I just use a soft varnish brush, and I just put just the tip of it into the varnish, and then I scrub it just like you were doing with your background trees. I scrub it to get it into all of the valleys. And so because it's just a soft patina, it doesn't look shiny at all. Just a soft patina.
All right, we're done.
Yay!
Ni me quizás.